morning.
To our Sunday gathering, the special Sunday. And again, we welcome all of you who are joining us online. And a special greeting to all the fathers. Happy Father's Day. And we want to welcome Margie, Auntie Margie, for the Margie to come to the stage. And she's going to open up our time together and pray. But this is the day that the Lord has made. And let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Everybody, please come in. Come in. Okay, let's pray for, this is a very special day for fathers and everyone who loves the Lord. A prayer for fathers today will be from Ephesians 3:14. We will offer this prayer to fathers as from Ephesians prayer for Ephesians. For this reason, we kneel before you, Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. Pray that out of his glorious riches, he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us. To him be glory in church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Amen.
God bless
everyone. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. What a wonderful day. The sun's shining. It's getting warm. Right, church? There's joy in the house of the Lord today. Amen. This is the day the Lord has made. Let it be glad. Rejoice in it. Amen. All right, church, we're going to praise the Lord. I want you to give him all you got. Come on, church, let's praise him.
Open the prison door.
to say.
Oh,
honor of all of our dads, we are so blessed that our women's ministry is leading our service, and we want to invite Carlita to come, and she's going to pray for our time together. And again, thank you to the women's ministry for leading. Appreciate you. Thank you, Carlita, for praying.
Look at that. The men are señoritos this morning. Yeah. And we are so happy that we have a strong women.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
I mean, the service. I mean.
For once.
That is just an introduction. You know me, if I talk, I have to look at your watch. Because there are times that my husband would say, I have to shorten here. And he is looking at me now. Okay, what a wonderful day. Are you glad that you are here today?
Amen.
Amen.
Why did you not go to the mall? Okay. All right. Shall we pray then? Almighty God,
yes.
Our loving Heavenly Father,
yes.
What a wonderful, great, and beautiful day that your hands have made for all the people to see and enjoy the beauty of your creation. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we have to rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for bringing us together in this lovely worship place. Thank you, dear Lord, for all your goodness to us. You are a great God. You are our wonderful God, Lord. Good God, because you are a stronghold in times of trouble. You are our strength. You are our refuge. Thank you, Heavenly Father, that in spite of all these difficulties that we are having due to this pandemic, still we can sense your presence in us. You give us all the wonderful things, Lord, for us to always see the presence of your Holy Spirit within us. Thank you for the privilege of having this wonderful day today as we are to celebrate Father's Day. Oh God, thank you for all the fathers that are here today. Thank you, Lord, that you have made these fathers to be a role model of all the children. Thank you, Father, that we can have you. Lord, we have nothing to ask you, Lord, because you have been so good to us all these times.
Yes.
We pray, Lord, that you bless all the people that are worshiping you today, not only in our own church, but throughout all the church, Lord, who are worshiping you in spirit and in truth. We pray, Lord, that may you guide each and every one of them, Lord. Help them to enjoy life. Help them, Lord, that as we enjoy life together, may it be that our lives will also be a blessing to those people whom we meet, to those people whom we come in contact with, so that through us they may see the beauty of how good it is to have you in our lives. Oh God, bless each and every one of us today. Bless every family that are present today, oh God. You know their needs. You know their desires in life. And we ask you, oh Heavenly Father, that as you have been so good to us all these times, may it be that you will listen to our concern today, our heart's cry, our desires, dear Lord. May it be that it will only be for your honor and your glory. Father in heaven, we are so grateful that you are our strength. You are our refuge, dear Lord. We ask you, O God, that even as we continue to worship you today in spirit and in truth, may you help us open our hearts as you know our needs. As we listen to your words today, may you help us, O God, so that anything, everything that you would want us to say and to enjoy through the speaker, O God, may you be magnified. Bless the speaker as well. Thank you for all the wisdom that you have given her. Thank you, Lord, that you have been so good. You really are so good to us. Our Heavenly Father, we ask you that we continue to bless each and every one of us, O God, today. Help us to enjoy this day, dear Lord. Help us to be faithful to you. Help us always, Lord, to let our light shine before men, that they may see our good works and glorify you. And to those who have not accepted you yet as their own personal Savior, may you be with each and every one of them. Again, Lord, give us a wonderful day. Help us to enjoy this day again, O God. And we give you all the glory, all the praises, Lord, because you are worthy of all the praises that we can offer you today. For this we ask in your name.
Amen.
You may be seated now. Thank you.
Part of our service today, which is our giving. I urge everyone to give cheerfully, freely, obediently, faithfully to the Lord today, because everything that we have, big or small, He has provided. Okay, ushers, please. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for giving us this day. Thank you for the opportunity to give to you today. Lord, I pray that you continue to bless us and help us, Lord, to be faithfully giving, Lord. I pray, Lord, that use our little token, Lord, as a symbol of our love, our faithfulness, our obedience, Lord, to you. And Lord, use this gift, Lord, as for the expansion of your kingdom, Lord. That's the gift and the giver as well. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Me again.
You're good.
Surprise! Okay, this is our main event. I would like to introduce to you our lovely speaker, Mrs. Joyce Tobusta. Hi, my sister. It is a great opportunity for me to be standing in front of you. I think I don't need to introduce who I am. I am the only, one and only, wife of my husband. But among her girls before. But I won his heart. And I was given three. God gave us three children. The two were up there, Romuland and Carmel. And our eldest, Daniel, is down with his dad, with my mom and dad. I am so thankful today. Actually, it is a great honor and privilege to stand before you to share God's word entitled, Carmel. Okay, entitled An Ideal Father. Our text today is found in Psalms 128 verses 1 to 6. But before that, let us pray. Our most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we are so thankful for your love. Thank you, O Lord, for this opportunity for us to honor our fathers. Thank you, Lord, for we have our fathers who demonstrated their love and taught us to come to you and worship you. Lord, I pray as we study your word, may your name be glorified. And I pray, Lord, that you anoint the tongue of your speaker. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Amen. What kind of home is your home? I want to find out later. I'll ask you again this question. What kind of home is your home? Let us see a video and let's find out what kind of home is our home. I ask you to sing with the song. The lyrics are there for us to sing.
Trouble, trouble, the devil in the family. Trouble, trouble.
One day, where a house was steadily burning down to the ground. He noticed that there was a little boy standing with his mom and dad. So the reporter came to the boy and said, "Son, it looks like you don't have a home anymore." But the little boy answered courageously. He said, "We have a home. We just don't have a house to put it in." Is a house a home? Or is a home a house? I want to ask you, what do you mean or what do you think when we say a home? Any answer? Anybody? Sister, sis, tuturo ko. To you, what is a house?
A house is consists with loving family.
A home. But what is a house?
A house is a house.
A house is a house. Who else? Yes, Kuya.
Well, it's well known that it's taken from the song, "A house is not a home when there's nobody living there." Mm-hmm. But the family takes care of everybody. And it's a home.
Thank you. You are very good people. You know the answer. So, a house is a building occupied by a person or a family. A house becomes a home when the family or the center of family who lives there has the trust, respect, TLC, tender loving care, and where love abound. That is a home. So I'll go back to my question to you. Is your home a house or a home? Or is your home a happy home? Someone has said, having somewhere to go to is a home. Having someone to love is family. But if you have a home and a family, you have a blessing from them. What do you own? Is it just a mere home? A mere house? Or a comfortable house and a home? I want to read to you Psalms 128 verses 1 to 6. And I'm reading it from the NLT. How joyful are those who fear the Lord,
all who follow his ways. You will enjoy the fruit of your labor. How joyful and prosperous you will be. Your wife will be like a fruitful grapevine, flourishing within your home. Your children will be like vigorous young olive trees as they sit around your table. That is the Lord's blessing for those who fear him. May the Lord continually bless you from Zion. May you see Jerusalem prosper as long as you live. May you live to enjoy your grandchildren. In this passage, it's showing us a picture of a happy home. We were taught in this passage that the only way to obtain the blessing that will make our families comfortable and contented is to live in the fear of the Lord and in obedience to him. The word fear does not mean to be afraid of, but it means reverence. Those who do so will be blessed. If we go back to verses 2, 3, and 4, you will enjoy the fruit of your labor, how joyful and prosperous you will be. Your wife will be like a fruitful grapevine, flourishing within your home. Your children will be like vigorous young olive trees as they sit around your table. That is the Lord's blessing for those who fear him. In particular, number one, in verse 2, they will be prosperous and successful in their work if we fear the Lord. The second one, their relationships will be pleasant. They will live to see their families brought up. They will have the satisfaction of seeing the church of God flourishing. That is in verses 5 and 6. And the most important truth in establishing a home, unless the Lord builds it, it will not work. Remember the chorus that we have seen? With Jesus in the family, happy, happy home. The family was God's idea, and he wants to be the head of every household. Until God is made the head of every household, all attempts to establish a strong family will end in frustration. That is found in Psalms 127, verse 1. It says, unless the Lord builds a house, the work of the builders is wasted. Unless the Lord protects a city, guarding it with sentries will do no good. So we have to let God be the God in our family. The honorees of today's celebration are the fathers. Children, do you love your fathers?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Wives, do you love your husbands?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes, that's good. I'm so happy to hear that. Once more, wives, do you love your husbands?
Oh, yes.
Thank you. Which one, huh? No, I know you love your husbands. What is a father to you? What is a household? Household consists of one or several persons who live in the same building or in the same dwelling and share meals. That's what the Webster Dictionary tells us. But what is a father? I have here an acronym of the word father. F is faithful and true. A, always there to guide you. T, teaches you right things to do and to do no wrong.
Letter H. His counsels are my song. Letter E. Ever firm in imparting his ideals and principles. And letter R. Ready to catch me each time I fall. That is a father. It's very good, huh? Our fathers are faithful and true, not only to us as their children, but to our moms, to the wife. Strength and wisdom and guidance are what makes a man a father. But what makes him a dad? It's the love that makes man a dad. An ideal father is the man who fears the Lord. Ideal father. What do we mean by the word ideal father? My best friend, Webster Dictionary, said, ideal father puts family before work, encourages his kids for the smallest reason that make the child happy, like making a project in class, for example. When it comes to family and work, family should always come first. I know that our fathers are working, but I also know that when family or when their children come and ask them to do something, special projects, special things, broken cars and everything, they leave their work and do what their children are asking them to do. That is an ideal father. An ideal father is a dad who loves his wife and a dad who loves his children. Again, our honor is, our beloved honor is for the day. Fathers, I have a question to you. Do you have any doubts about the importance of your role as a father or as a parent? Or as a parent? Husbands to your wife and father to your children. Is there any time that that question comes to your mind? Did you doubt being the father, being a parent, being a husband to your wife? Let us find out the guidelines of God in the scriptures as to the role of a model or ideal father. Let me read Colossians chapter 3, verses 18 to 20. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting to those who belong to the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and never treat them harshly. Children, obey your parents, for this pleases the Lord. This is a very good picture of a Christian home. Paul's exhortation is based in Jesus' example. The Son lived his life on earth in perfect submission to the will of the Father. Context is helpful as well. The wife's submission is the response to the sacrificial love of her husband. In Proverbs 18, verse 22 says, he who finds a wife finds what is good and receives favor from the Lord. Husbands, let your wife be a fountain of blessings to you. Let me read one more. Ephesians 5, verses 22 to 25. It says, for wives, this means submit to your husbands as to the Lord. For the husband is the head of his wife as Christ is the head of the church. He is the Savior of His body, the church. As the church submits to Christ, so you wives should submit to your husbands in everything. And verse 28 says, in the same way, husbands ought to love their wives as they love their own bodies. For a man who loves his wife actually shows love for himself. Loving your wife is the starting point of becoming a husband who cherishes, protects, and nourishes. No husband wakes up in the morning and says, I think I would love my wife today. Wives, did you hear that word or that phrase from your husbands? Husband saying, I think I will not love my wife today. Yet, by your actions, you may be doing just that. Husbands should love their wives as Christ loved the church unconditionally and sacrificially. Christ also demonstrated his love through his willing death on the cross. Likewise, husbands must lay down their lives for their wives. In marriage, selfishness is fatal, but sacrifice is life-giving. I want to repeat this. In marriage, selfishness is fatal, but sacrifice is life-giving. Husbands should love their wives purposely. Christ loved the church so that one day he might present her to himself as a glorious bride. A husband's goal in marriage should be to help his wife grow in godliness and become all that God intended her to be. A husband should love his wife tenderly and passionately, being responsive to her physical and emotional well-being. The frequent expressions of affection and approval that couples give each other during courtship and in the honeymoon stage can dwindle in the first year of marriage. You may still love each other just as much, but you start to talk about it less. Contrary to the fairy tales we were went on, romance always fades. But you can keep your romance love alive long after the honeymoon has ended. We love the song sweeter as the years go by. So let should have our marriage be sweeter as the years go by. The secret is simple. Do everything you can now to establish lasting habits of loving behavior. The habits you develop now can lead either to actions that will nurture lifelong love or to behaviors that will sabotage your love. The little things that you do now will shape your relationship for years to come. So pay attention to those little things. Keep love alive. Start now by establishing daily habits of romance, passion, and intimacy. Your honeymoon will become more than just a memory. It will become a way of life. These are the little things that I was talking about. We have the 10 keys to successful marriage by Kenneth Kalinske. Number one, talk with each other. Even though how busy you might be, spend time to talk with each other. Just say, how was your day today, my dear? Talk to them. Talk with each other. Number two, tell each other I love you.
Love you.
Question. When was the last time you whispered, I love you, to your spouse? Just now. I know, you say that. But for women, when our husband will tell us, I love you, even though we are sleepy, our hearts, because our husbands are telling us that they love us. So tell each other, and I know, when we tell that to our husband, they too are happy. So these little things that we say to them, it is a success, one of the successful keys for a successful marriage. Number three, touch each other. Next one, tantalize each other. Tease your husband. Husband, tease your wife. To tantalize means to arouse the expectation. If you tantalize or if you tease your wife will be happy all day. To rate each other. Next one is trust each other. Trust is very important to have a successful marriage. Treasure each other. Try to say thank you by thanking each other. You have to thank each other. And number 10, track with each other. What happened to my PowerPoint? Okay, thank you. The most important thing a father can do to his children is to love their mothers. This is from Theodore Hisburg. Do you know that the scriptures clearly give us the model for being not only a man, but also a husband and father? That model is called the servant leader. The model, the husband and the father, is to lead, to love, and to serve. Webster defines a leader as someone who commands authority or influence, who shows the way, who guides or conducts, who directs and governs. God designed this position of responsibility and mantle of leadership comes along with it. What we believe and obey of God's word will affect how we live our lives. Because parenting is a partnership, how you love and care for your wife is a major factor in caring for the children. The father is responsible for setting the pattern for the children's behavior and obedience in the family. Any discipline the mother does is an extension of the father's authority in the home. The husband and father must take leadership in this area of the family, and the wife and mother must be in submission. If your son or daughter will come to you and ask for permission, if the dad said no, mom, don't say yes. If the dad said yes, mom, don't say no. We have a secret at home. If one of the children will tell us, mom, can I go out with my friends? My first question, did you ask your dad? play safe. If they said, yeah, next question, what did he tell you? And if they say, yes, even though I don't like, I have to say yes. If they tell me, Dad said no, even though I like it, I say no. But if the answer is, go ask your mom, that is quite a risky decision to make. He's giving me the work, so I give back to him. I said, go back to your dad, ask him what he wants. So we have to be as a role model, as a dad, ideal dad. Mom and dad, mom being submissive to your wife, to your husband. We have to go the same direction. The father's responsibility, as what I have said, for setting the pattern for the child's behavior and obedience in the family. And that is the discipline. Children, listen as I read your role. In Ephesians 6, 1 to 3, children, Ephesians 6, 1, 2, 3, it says here, children, obey your parents because you belong to the Lord, for this is the right thing to do. Honor your father and mother. This is the first commandment with a promise. If you honor your father and mother, things will go well for you, and you will have a long life on the earth. This is our role as a children. The father's responsibility to us is found in verse 4. Fathers, do not provoke your children to anger by the way you treat them. Rather, bring them up with the discipline and instruction that comes from the Lord. In this verse, the father is set forth in two ways. First, what the father is not to do. It says, do not provoke your children to wrath. He is not to over-discipline them or reign in terror with the result that the child can only react in a blind outbreak that the child can do only to react in rage. And the second one, it says there, what the father is to do, but bring them up in the training and admonition of the Lord. To bring them up to the Lord includes three ideas. Number one, bringing up our children to the Lord and the training to the Lord is a continuous job. As long as the child is a dependent, the father is to be responsible for providing for the child so that he becomes what God wants him to be. Second, it is a long job. To bring up means literally to nourish tenderly. Children should be objects of tender, loving care. And the third one, it is a tough job involving nurture or child training. All that the child needs to his development, physically, mentally, and spiritually, and admonition of the Lord. If our faith in Christ is real, it will usually prove itself in our relationship at home with those who knew us best. Children and parents have responsibility to each other. Children should honor their parents, even if the parents are demanding and unfair. Parents should give gently to their children, even if the children are disobedient and unpleasant. Ideally, of course, Christian parents and Christian children will relate to each other with thoughtfulness and love. The purpose of parental discipline is to help children grow, not to exasperate and provoke them to anger or discouragement. Parenting is not easy. Who can tell me here that parenting is very easy? But we know, and I know, that parenting is not so easy. It takes a lot of patience to raise children in a loving, Christ-honoring manner. Parents should act in love, treating their children as Jesus treats the people he loves. This is vital to children's development and to their understanding of what Christ is like. Tim George has the 10 commandments of child raising. This is all from the Bible. Number one, teach them using God's word. Second, tell them what's right or wrong. Third commandment of child raising, see them as gifts from God. Number four, guide them in godly ways. The fifth one, discipline them. Love them unconditionally. This is the story of the prodigal son. Number seven, do not provoke them to wrath. Eight, earn the respect by example. Provide their physical needs. And the number 10 is pass your faith along to them. The key to teaching your children to love God is stated simply and clearly using God's word. It sets a pattern that helps us relate the word of God to our daily lives. God emphasized the importance of parents teaching the Bible to their children. I have a question. Fathers, do you have your Bibles with? Do you have Bibles at home? Yes. I have a question, follow-up question to them. Except my husband and my dad. Except pastor. Who among you fathers today brought your physical Bible? Who among you brought your Bibles with you? Kuya dads, let me see. I want a proof. Don't get the Bibles from the pews. Not the cell phone. You know, I am an old school person. I love social, I love phones. Kuya Das, come here, Kuya Dado. Come here. Bakit? Si Pastor lang bang marunong magbigay ng gift cards? Happy Father's Day. It pays to bring your Bible. Because I don't believe that we should use our cell phones to be our Bibles. Especially the I do not believe that we are to use our cell phones as our Bibles in the church. You can use your phones as your Bibles anywhere you go, but not in the church. That's what I believe. Because we are in God's house. We have to use His Bible. And as per record, Bibles are the best selling books still in the world. So why leave it in the shelf where dust accumulates it? Bring it to church. Thank you, Kuya, for bringing your Bible with you. If you want your children to love and serve God, you must make God a part of your everyday experience. I love Billy Graham. Billy Graham said, the greatest legacy one can pass on to one's children and grandchildren is not money or other material things accumulated in one's life, but rather a legacy of character and faith. What is an ideal father then? An ideal father is someone to turn to, someone dependable, someone to talk, to look up to, someone to talk with, someone who listens, willing to hear things through. He is someone respected, someone admired, someone to be thankful for. A father is someone to love. Fathers, I want to leave this to you. What will your sons and daughters remember most about you as their dad? Will they say, you were involved in their lives? Or were you physically or emotionally absent from their lives? Fathers, today is your special day. Happy, happy Father's Day. Fathers, I have some more cards here. I want to find out who is our oldest father here, with not the age, but a father whose son or daughter is the oldest among us. Who among you is the oldest father? Kuya Romy, how old is your oldest?
42.
42.
Higher than that, fathers? 45.
50.
Kuya Tato! Mas panganay si Miriam sa akin ng isang araw. Hindi nagpatalo, no? Buti na lang, mas matanda siya sa akin ng isang araw. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.
Happy, happy Father's Day. Fathers, thank you for being our father who taught us how to serve the Lord. Thank you, fathers, for being our role model, for loving our moms. Because of your love to our moms, we learn to love our spouses as well. Thank you so much. God bless you. Joining us online. Next on our worship part is a presentation from our children's ministry.
Thank you.
Good morning again, church. So just gonna give like a, you know, like inspirational message to all the fathers and us going through like some ideas and inspiration. I came along writing from Kurt Lodman, which was adapted by Deborah Mooney, and this is called Praises for Fathers. For all the fathers, this is for you. Let us praise those fathers who have striven to balance the demands of work, marriage, and children with honest awareness of both joy and sacrifice. Let us praise those fathers who, lacking a good model for a father, have worked to become a worthy and virtuous father. Let us praise those fathers who, by their own account, were not always there for their children, but who continued to offer those children, now grown, their love and support. As well, let us pray for those fathers who have been wounded by words and actions of their children. Let us praise those fathers who, despite marital discord, have remained in their children's lives. Let us praise those fathers whose children are adopted and whose love and support has nurtured a thriving life. Let us praise those fathers who, as stepfathers, freely choose the obligation of fatherhood and earn their stepchildren's love and respect. Let us praise those fathers who have lost a child to death and continue to hold the child in their heart. Let us praise those men who have no children but cherish the next generation as if they were their own. Let us praise those men who have fathered us in their role as mentors and guides. Let us praise those men who are about to become fathers. May they openly delight in their children. And let us praise those fathers who have died but live in our memory and whose love continues to nurture us. Happy Father's Day to all fathers. And now we have some video presentation for our fathers.
Small things such as my glasses.
Hard working and he does my stuff for me and my mom.
When he feeds me oranges and he makes me food, he helps me with my
homework sometimes when I need help. And when I'm struggling with stuff, I also help him do stuff while he's working. And he takes care of me when my mom's at work.
He's funny.
and he's caring, and he's always doing stuff for other people, and he makes sure that we're always having a good time, and he takes care of all of us.
Drive, how to drive stick shift, how to maintain a good credit score, teaching me how to get a car loan, helping me purchase my first car.
Paying the bills for us, food for us, for all of our cool stuff in our rooms.
For taking me to camping, bringing me to national parks, and buying me stuff for my Nintendo Switch.
For taking care of us, for guiding me through life, cooking us food, taking care of Lexi.
For buying our dog and make sure we do have a good room.
All that you've done for us growing up and even now, for always looking out for us and making sure that we're okay. I admire your work ethic, your eagerness to help where you can, and your complete trust in God. You often say, don't worry about anything, but instead pray about everything.
For having you as my dad, salamat po sa lahat, mga advice, pagtawag, pangamusta whenever you were in the Philippines. Thank you din po sa pagmamahal.
Putting our family first, for you know, for protecting us all the time and making us your priority.
Take care of yourself, Daddy, and thank you for everything that you've done. I pray that may God continue to bless you and feel the precious of your heart.
Playing me with the Lakers and thanks for fixing my doors and putting batteries all in me.
For being such a hardworking dad and for always being there for us and for keeping us in our faith. Always supporting us, motivating us, and leading us towards God. I'll always appreciate you. You see, I'm kidding, okay?
Strong and healthy and happy.
Everything that you do for us and for providing and being the best dad that you are.
For cooking and barbecuing here. All your food is great. Thank you for supporting us and helping us with the house.
Taking care of us, make sure we take care of you so that you can pick me up when I go to school next week.
Make sure you stay safe and make sure you're being healthy and make sure you beat cancer.
Making us sandwiches, letting us play on your things for piggybacks.
For making yummy food.
Guiding me when we are at the Philippines. Make sure you stay healthy and safe. And also make sure you have a safe flight back to the Philippines.
Thank you for taking care of us.
I want to say thank you, Dad.
Thank you.
Thank you for
all of that.
We love you.
Love you, Dad.
Love you.
Love you.
Bye.
Love you.
Love you too.
Happy birthday.
first time you touched me.
Yeah.
you know, our fathers of the church, for everything that you do for all of us, for the church, for our community, for the Bell Court, uplifting everybody. So for a small token of appreciation, we just like you to give little token.
Bible School is coming up the last week of July. We have an informational meeting right after church next Sunday, so that will be a quick meeting right after church, correct? Also, with the church board, we are exploring the idea of having potlucks again after church, and so we're looking at the mid-July to launch potlucks again, and so we're still being a little bit more patient, and we're seeing as the opening is beginning to open again to launch potlucks mid-July, so just know about that. And also during the mid-July, we're going to be honoring our graduates, all of our graduates across the board from middle school to college, so that just know mid-July we'll be honoring that as well in terms of our graduates. One last thing I remember. Anyways, camping, that's right, camping, Labor Day weekend, September 3rd, 4th, and 5th at Lake, what?
California.
Lake California. We explored and attempted to go to other places, but long story short, we are back at Lake California, so we're excited by that. Amen?
Amen.
All right, we bless the food now, or you want to, it's up to you.
Closing prayer.
It's good to have you in service.
Hello, church. Please stand and let's pray for the closing prayer. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Lord, Father in heaven, we want to thank you and we praise you for the special Father's Day celebration today and for the wonderful love that you've shown us today, especially. Lord, your Holy Spirit, thank you for the Holy Spirit who guided and will help us to understand your will, which you revealed in your word. Thank you for sister for the beautiful message as she delivered, and continually use her as instrument to preach the gospel, O Lord. Thank you for your mercies and care that you have provided today. And also bless the food that we are going to partake, and also to those sisters who prepared the food and the gifts for all the fathers. And also bless those brothers and sisters that are not here today, and to those watching online. Bless each and every one of us as we live in this place, and disperse us to our various home. Bless our conversation. Grant us journey, mercies, protection. Thank you for the church leadership and all of us in general, and all the children of God will say, Amen.